All right, good morning.
Am I getting a, we getting a feedback? We good? Oh, okay, that was you.
I would like to call this hearing of the House Game and Fisheries Committee to order. The purpose of this hearing is to discuss the problem of abandoned boats on our rivers, streams, all our waterways in Pennsylvania. I know this is a big issue across Pennsylvania. We have, I see folks online. I see Rep Haddock, Rep O'Neill online. And I'd ask any members, we're going to have questions at the end. So if you have any questions, we're going to wait till testimony has been taken. I also would like the opportunity to have anyone from the audience who might have questions also. We have some wonderful speakers here today, and I would like to have the audience to have an opportunity also to be heard. So we'll leave some time for that. Thank you all for coming to this beautiful Science Center, and I'd like to thank everybody from the Science Center today for having us. This is a great location. We have a great view out the window. Take a look when you're done. And we do have some official business to take care of first, so I would ask my staff to take roll call, please.
Okay.
And if you are online, if you can jump in when it's your turn.
Representative Hohenstein. Representative Mirsky. Representative Boyd.
On leave.
Representative Cerisi.
Morning.
On leave.
Representative Deloso. Representative Friel.
On leave.
Representative Gurgley. Representative Garal. Representative Haddock.
Representative Haddock's online.
Representative Kazim.
On leave.
Representative McNeil.
Representative McNeil is with us.
Representative Paelli.
Representative Paelli is on leave.
Representative Steele.
Ellen's going to call.
Good morning.
He's at school. And Representative. She's getting in touch with them.
Can whoever's online has their mic on, can you turn it off? Thank you.
Chair Kulik.
Here.
Representative DeVanzo.
On leave.
Representative Wendling. Leave.
See, okay. Oh, I'm sorry. Leave.
Representative Banta. Present virtually.
I'm here, yes. Thank you.
Representative Cabell.
On leave.
Representative Dorsey.
On leave.
Representative Ecker.
On leave.
Representative Flick.
On leave.
Representative Kuzma.
On leave.
Representative Labs.
On leave.
Representative Mercury. And Chair Maloney.
Chair Maloney, are you with us? Okay, we will catch up with my co-chair when he gets online. I would also like to introduce Senator Williams, who's here with us today. Thank you so much for coming out with us. Before we get started, and I'll turn it back over to the senator for a couple words, this is almost a perfect day to be having this hearing. Yesterday was a really terrible day across the state, especially here in western Pennsylvania. I'd like to just take a moment to remember, and I know some of you sitting here were out doing your jobs last night in the bad weather and the flooding weather. So I want to take a moment to just remember all of our first responders who were out last night and are still out. I know all of us here today have municipalities that are suffering from floods. So, you know, a special thank you to all our fire, police, EMS, and our swift water rescue teams that we all have in our districts for being out and keeping our municipality safe, keeping our residents safe. And thank God I have not had any word of any injuries to our residents or to our EMS personnel, our first responding personnel. We can always clean up the water in our basements. We can always flush out whatever problems we have. but life is precious, and I cannot thank enough all the people who were out from our municipalities last night taking care of it, and our folks, I think, from the Fish and Boat Commission were also out doing the same. And I see that Representative Maloney has joined us. Representative, would you like to say a few words before we get started?
I appreciate your shout out to the first responders, and I sort of had to make a last minute change of my plans to not be there. So I apologize for that, but glad to participate in any way I can. Thank you.
Thank you. And always, you know, I told the members yesterday, safety first, anybody driving across state to get here today. Representative Williams.
Oops. That's okay.
Senator Williams. I apologize.
That's okay. Thank you. Yes, I'm Senator Williams. I represent the 38th District here in Allegheny County. I sit on the Senate Game and Fisheries Committee and also a member of the Port of Pittsburgh. So this is an issue I hear about a lot. So thank you to Chair Kulik for including the Senate in her invitation for being here today. So I'm looking forward to learning more, and also echo my thanks for all the first responders out keeping us safe last night.
And I'll thank all of the members from the House who are with us. We have a great bipartisan participation today, so thank you all for being here. We will get started. If you're speaking, we're gonna ask that you come up here. We're gonna also ask that you introduce yourself as you speak, and we're gonna get started with Mr. Littman from the Pennsylvania Fish and Boat Commission. Is he here? And we want to welcome Tim Schaefer here. If you want to come up too, Tim Schaefer is the executive director of the Fish and Boat Commission and really was the driving force behind us meeting here today.
Great, and thanks, Chair. And I'll turn this over to Paul here, but I did want to thank the committee for your attention to this issue. It has garnered national attention. Know that we've shared this with our colleagues from throughout the country, and a lot of people are paying attention. Also want to thank the Pittsburgh Safe Boating Council, Scott Harshman, and others who kicked this off with a meeting in this room some time ago where the issue was raised, and we took it seriously, and we thank the chair for taking it seriously. Two other notes, though, before I turn it to Paul. One is to thank Jason Brown for this phenomenal facility. Thanks to the folks at the Carnegie Science Center for hosting us today. And then the last piece on the public safety with my button here is, you know, wear your life jacket. Reminder that in Pennsylvania, we have a mandatory life jacket wear on all canoes, kayaks, and boats under 16 feet from November 1st through April 30th. So it is the law this time of year to wear your life jacket. Since that regulation has been in place, we've seen fatalities be cut in half in the cold weather months. But it really is the best idea to wear your life jacket all year long. Each year, about 80% of the voting fatalities are a result of people not wearing life jackets. So with that, I'll turn it over to my colleague, Paul Littman, and just thanks to everybody for being here, and thank you for hosting the hearing.
Well, thank you. Good morning, Chairs Kulik and Maloney and committee members. My name is Paul Littman, and I'm the director of Pennsylvania Fish and Boat Commission's Bureau of Boating. Thank you for inviting the commission and other key partners to share their perspectives and experiences concerning the emergent concern of abandoned and derelict vessels. And the rest of this, I'll refer to abandoned and derelict vessels as ADVs. I'm pleased to be among this network of federal, state, and local entities coming together to discuss this important issue and collaborate on potential solutions. The Commission has a long history of regulating the operation of boats and encouraging, promoting, and developing recreational boating on the waters of this Commonwealth. Additionally, the Commission is responsible for administering a recreational boating safety program approved by and on behalf of the United States Coast Guard. The Commission has been involved in the growing discussions around the topics of ADVs around the nation. As many of you know, this topic rose to prominence in Pennsylvania last year when a large recreational boat was abandoned along the Allegheny River, approximately 1/2 mile from where this hearing is today. Unfortunately, it was one of several abandoned boats in the Three Rivers area and representative of an issue occurring across the Commonwealth. There are many complex issues at play when a boat is abandoned in the waters of the Commonwealth, and these issues are not unique to Pennsylvania. It is against this backdrop that I'd like to outline some central concepts that underlie the discussion of ADVs, as well as the problems that ADVs can cause, including a few considerations to keep in mind when developing solutions. Key problems. ADVs can create environmental hazards, particularly when boats become partially or totally submerged. Fuel, oil, antifreeze, sewage, batteries, and other environmental contaminants upon board boats are at risk of entering the waterway. These boats can pose a multiple of safety hazards, such as becoming a navigational hazard for recreational or commercial boat traffic. As is often the case here in Pittsburgh, these vessels occupy premium space where other recreational boaters could dock or moor their boats. Abandoned vessels that create waterway obstructions can lead to severe injury or even death. ADVs are generally a nuisance, which may lure inquisitive persons into exploring a scene that is likely more dangerous than it appears, or invite undesirable activities such as vandalism, loitering, theft, and arson. Lastly, ADVs are an eyesore that detract from the scenic and aesthetic values Pennsylvanians have come to expect along their waterways. Key terms. Abandonment can occur as a boat advances gradually towards disrepair, or it can happen as a sudden event. Therefore, it's helpful to think about boats progressing along a continuum from brand new to being disposed of properly when no longer useful. At a point along a continuum, a boat can be considered at risk of becoming derelict, or abandoned. These vessels often need substantial and expensive work. If repairs or attention to risks are not addressed, these boats may eventually become derelict. And a derelict boat is not operational, but it still has an identifiable owner. The owner is responsible for properly disposing of a derelict boat, and the owner of a boat registered in Pennsylvania must notify the commission, owner of a powerboat or motorized vessel registered in Pennsylvania must notify the commission when the boat is no longer in service or changes ownership. Unfortunately, some owners choose to neglect their responsibility and abandon their boat, leaving others to deal with it and contributing to a nationwide problem. Key considerations. The process of addressing an ADV can be lengthy, costly, and may involve many different entities. Initial reports of an ADV need to be verified and investigated by law enforcement. An officer must collect vessel data, review the circumstances to develop the next steps. Does a boat pose a threat to the environment or navigation? Who owns the boat? Why is it here? Who abandoned it? Who controls the property where the boat was abandoned? What site-specific challenges exist for removing the boat? And these answers can be complicated and often difficult to discover. Close coordination between federal, state, and local entities is key to developing a course of action for abandoned vessels, especially in the case of large recreational boats containing potential pollutants. Initial actions entail researching the chain of ownership and providing the rightful owner with sufficient opportunity to reclaim the possession of the boat. They may also involve securing the services of parties with the skills and the resources to remove or mitigate environmental hazards, lift the boat out of the waterway, and transport the boat for storage or disposal. Boat owners are responsible for the costs of removal, storage, and, if necessary, disposal, in addition to the costs of dealing with pollution events or removal of potential pollutants. In the event an owner does not reclaim the boat, it may be claimed by the commission, a landowner, a salvor, or any other entity and resold and disposed of properly. To successfully address the complex issue of ADVs, both proactively and when they end up abandoned on Commonwealth waterways, will likely require a multi-pronged approach. The Commission looks forward to working with the partners here in the room today and other stakeholders to address ADVs through the development of policies and programs that are appropriate for the types of recreational boats used on Pennsylvania waters. Thank you again for the opportunity to testify today, and thank you to the partners who are able to join us today. And I would be happy to answer any questions.
Thank you. We're going to hold questions till after everyone testifies. And I again want to thank so many folks who are here today. I know we have representatives from municipalities here who have these issues, and also from boat clubs here. So thank you for coming out and joining us today. So we will next hear from Jesse McArdle from the National Marine Manufacturers Association.
Oh, perfect. Good morning, Chair Astorino, and Lead Maloney and members of the Game and Fisheries Committee. My name is Jesse McArdle. I serve as the Midwest and Northeast Policy and Engagement Manager for the National Marine Manufacturers Association. Just by a quick way of background, NMMA is the lead trade association for the recreational boating industry. Our members manufacture over 80% of the boats, trailers, engines, and accessories used by anglers and recreational boaters in the United States and Canada. And before I jump in, I just want to mention too that boating is, big business and a huge passion here in the Commonwealth. We have an estimated economic impact of $4.5 billion every year, supporting over 16,000 jobs and 557 businesses. In NMMA, we've been very intimately involved in helping develop ADV policies throughout the country, and really look forward to continuing this very important work with you all here today, and just kind of outlining some areas where we've seen success around the country in dealing with abandoned and derelict vessels. And so just for starters, I think sort of the big mindset that we take going into, looking at ADV policy is, really a consideration of the life cycle use of the boat, how long it's been on the water and in use, and the degree of negligence that's been displayed by the owner in its upkeep. Just keeping these two considerations in mind is very important in trying to get the boat off of the water to, ensure that there's not further environmental degradation while also ensuring due process rights. But I'd like to further drill down into two areas of ADV policy we've seen a lot of success in for collection rates and mitigation. Particularly down in the state of Florida, there's more registered boats in Florida than any other state in the country. And last year, they successfully removed over 700 watercraft from the waters that were in a degraded state. And one of the main tools they used for this was having different classification types for different watercraft between a wrecked vessel, a junked vessel, and a substantially dismantled vessel. And this provides some clarity and consistency in addressing maritime hazards, as well as classifying which boats need to come off the water first, which municipalities can maybe take a little bit more time to work through due to, less concerns over environmental degradation. In another area we've seen a lot of success, both in Florida and out west in states like Washington and Oregon, are instances where states have reallocated some funding from, different recreational accounts as well as different boat registration fee programs to also help supplement some of the funding in trying to remove vessels. It can help with the disparity in cost between the removal of commercial and recreational vessels, since the cost is usually the biggest concern, frankly, that we run into. Both amongst users and municipalities, states, etc. And we do believe that by incorporating these diverse definitions or categories for derelict vessels and enhancing the efficacy of these programs, we really will mitigate the greatest risk to human and environmental safety, which is our biggest concern. I'd also just like to quickly mention that another part that we of the Florida ADV program that we've seen work really successful is sort of the grant guidelines they put into place, which afford ongoing grant applications with no fixed deadlines contingent upon the availability of funding. This has produced, again, really expeditious and efficient intervention results to date, with over 700 boats taken off the water last year. And the provision mandating an opportunity for vessel owners to contest these designations of their vessels has helped from a legal standpoint with different due process concerns and, you know, property taking concerns. I would just say, too, that we would also, you know, really encourage the committee and the state of Pennsylvania, too, to take a look at what Rhode Island has done with some of their different classifications and redistribution out of their boating restoration fund that's went to ADV programs. So, yeah, in conclusion, really do appreciate the time today. Again, just wanted to kind of outline some areas where we've seen this policy work really well, and really look forward to trying to get a really good, strong program in the Commonwealth as well. And before I conclude, I would be remiss not to thank the Game and Fisheries Committee for all their great work, as well as the Fish and Boat Commission. They've been really great partners to us on this and a variety of issues. So thank you.
Thank you. And yeah, we know it is a burden to the municipalities cost-wise, and also to a lot of the marinas who have to deal with this. So thank you so much. Captain Evan Clark from Three Rivers Riverkeeper. Good morning.
Oop. All right, now we're on. Good morning, Chairs Kulik, Maloney, and committee members and staff. My name's Captain Evan Clark, and I'd like to thank you for the invitation to speak here today. As a member and past treasurer of the Pittsburgh Safe Boating Council, I'm here representing the council on this important issue related to the abandonment and abandoned and derelict vessel along our Commonwealth's waterways, and especially here in the Pittsburgh region. I work for Three Rivers Waterkeeper as our local waterkeeper. We are a local and internationally affiliated nonprofit with a mission to protect everyone's right to clean water that is fishable, swimmable, and drinkable. I have a United States Coast Guard 100-ton Inland Masters captain's license and also serve as part-time captain of our local Explorer riverboat operated by Rivers of Steel. Over the last 17 years, I've been involved with Allegheny Cleanways and our group of tireless volunteers and have cleaned up over 1 million pounds of trash in Allegheny County. I've lived, worked, and traveled on thousands of miles of rivers along the entire Mississippi River Basin, including the Allegheny, Monongahela, and Ohio Rivers. And I'd also like to thank the Pennsylvania Fish and Boat Commission under the leadership of Executive Director Timothy Schaefer and Deputy Executive Director Laurel Anders as they work to address this abandoned boats issue. Within the last 6 months, the Fish and Boat Commission has solicited a survey on this topic in which I led a committee of the Safe Boating Council in providing a response to the survey. I'd also like to recognize both Michael Hills, Vice President of the Pittsburgh Safe Boating Council and owner of Freedom Boat Club and manager of the Station Square Marina, and who is with us here today, as well as Hannah Homan with Three Rivers Waterkeeper, who both served on this committee and helped in drafting our survey response. Much of my testimony today is derived from our shared experiences, research, and work in preparing the survey response. Abandoned and derelict vessels impact our quality of life. We see abandoned and derelict vessels, sometimes referred to as ADVs, in Pittsburgh and throughout the region. They're a problem on land, abandoned in marinas for owners to deal with, as well as on city streets, in alleys, over hillsides, and of course we find them in the water. Both abandoned as a disposal technique and left derelict in the public spaces around Pittsburgh's Point area to avoid paying for dockage. These boats harm our riverfronts for residents, visitors, fishermen, and boaters. This is especially problematic as these rivers recover from decades of blight, abuse, and neglect. and we are still culturally working towards finding a way back to embracing, caring for, and valuing our refound wealth in these once dead rivers. Abandoned boats in the focal center of the region negate many people's and organizations' years of hard work. They pose a threat to our river's ecosystems. Many leak fuel, oil, debris, and other hazards into our rivers, where in the Ohio Valley, 5 million people source their drinking water. They also pose a hazard to commercial navigation and the critical working infrastructure of our lock and dam system. Further, these boats, abandoned or derelict in crowded public spaces near sports venues and our convention center, pose a possible public safety threat from being an attractive nuisance to a possible tool of terrorism. Often, these ADVs end up getting tied to the North Shore Wall in Pittsburgh near Acrisure Stadium and PNC Park, where they sit year-round until nature takes its course. Flood events can claim them, as we've seen in the past week and days, and they start to deteriorate. They can freeze in winter, and inevitably, they sink. There are not generally understood best practices for owners to dispose of these boats, and owners who buy boats cheap are often surprised by the disposal cost and unable to pay for best practices. Lack of insurance often compounds this issue. This method of disposal has few or no actual consequences to the responsible parties, as our laws lack teeth and precedent for use, and other legal, infrastructural, and jurisdictional issues get in the way of these results. We also commonly see abandoned boats all throughout the rest of the region. The majority sit on land, but the toughest to deal with are the ones on the rivers and near their banks. These range in size from small canoes and kayaks to 80-foot passenger vessels. Many of these boats are traceable back to known owners, but that, paradoxically, legally, makes them even harder to deal with. If they had no markings or clear history, and if the resources were there, they could be gathered, cut up, and dumped. Interested parties, ranging from landowners, riverfront beautification, and stewardship-focused nonprofits, marina owners, concerned citizens, municipalities, and law enforcement are all stymied in their efforts to deal with these boats, as taking them on costs significant time, money, and pose a very uncertain legal liability. Especially since for a non-governmental entity to take them on basically requires the person or organization to take full ownership and liability for a boat that has significant and rapidly declining negative value and could cause challenging, at best, environmental issues. Crucially, there is rarely motivation for our three or so well-equipped salvage companies in the area to touch these boats due to these legal and financial reasons. I'll talk about what you would likely see nearby along the rivers today. There are a few specific examples of ADVs that are on our rivers right now. There are many more, 14 by my last count in the county as I speak, but these boats that I'll talk about here represent a general cross-section of our issues. There's a boat that I call the sideways boat. That's a large, approximately 75-foot abandoned steel excursion boat on the Allegheny River, laying on its side across from Lock Wall 1 Marina, that had been there for decades, apparently stuck in a lawsuit dating back to 2020 between a salvage, ooh, I have that one wrong, 2002, between a salvage company and the vessel's owner. There's foam-filled pieces of barges. Within 50 feet of this sideways boat are a few approximately 30-foot square sections of cut-up steel foam-filled barge. One of these pieces last week in high water floated down and got lodged on the upstream side of Pittsburgh's public safety floating boathouse, housing their river rescue boats. If they push it off their landing, it'll float downstream and likely end up like another foam-filled steel barge that was lodged in Emsworth Lock and partially halted their operations a few years back. Another boat is the old Voyager. Last seen is another approximately 80-foot wooden stripped hull, an ex-Navy YP Yard Patrol boat, converted to an educational excursion boat, roughly 25 miles up the Monongahela and 100 feet from shore. The last owners sold it to a now out-of-business marine operator who then apparently beached it, removed anything of value, and left it in the river floodplain, where, due to it being a wooden boat, could refloat in a flood like today and cause havoc on its way downriver. There are a few stacked boats on Bruno Island. These two stacked boats, 22 and 18-foot fiberglass hulls, clearly dumped allegedly by a local marina owner, one inside the other on the main channel shore of Bruno Island, is in the first miles of the Ohio River. And there's a burnt boat behind Davis Island. This is a fiberglass boat located in the back channel behind Davis Island on the Ohio, roughly 24 feet long, which was dumped in 2022. It's now been burnt to the waterline after sitting for half a year. And another one that was last seen there seems to have washed away, possibly into the dam a mile downstream. And then, of course, there's the boats at Pittsburgh's Point. There are two boats at the moment. Well, I've just heard this morning, one now, on the North Shore River Wall in Pittsburgh on the Allegheny River. One is sunk, but still tied to the wall. It has been sunk and raised now three, maybe four times now, and the other is still afloat. Talk a little bit about my personal perspective. I'd like to highlight three of my individual experiences with the ADV issue for the committee. In 2016, while working with Allegheny Cleanways, we cut up a 20-foot fiberglass boat stuck upstream from the Monongahela Wharf, south of downtown. It was a nightmare and a good lesson in the need for expensive, heavy equipment with skilled operators to handle any riparian boat disposal job. Some quick research and calls that I made later in 2023 indicated that an average 23-foot boat in our area could be pulled from the water, ground up, and landfilled for as little as $2,000 apiece if the work were done in batches of six or more boats in a straightforward salvage and disposal job. On the other hand, the same boat could cost $50,000 to deal with or much more. Sinking in a critical area could make the salvage job an expensive priority. Leaking fuel and oil places a burden on our emergency services, who sometimes aren't even available or under-equipped. Issues around ownership are notoriously hard to resolve, and then storage or other complicating factors could drive the costs up.
It's amazing what we can arrange here.
You can't make this stuff up.
Sorry to interrupt.
Oh, yeah. No, not at all. I think that was the perfect interruption. I think it's one of the ones that was tied up along the river wall. Yeah. It's now the boat that's risen and gone down three or four times, and it's now going away. Well... Emsworth Lock. Yeah, Emsworth Lock.
I think it's going to head down the Ohio in my district.
Yeah. Yeah, it's probably going to be the Corps of Engineers problem to deal with pretty soon if it doesn't get hung up in a marina and start knocking docks off of their pilings. Not anymore. That boat's been up and down so many times. Probably just fiberglass at this point, but... Yeah, other complicating factors could drive the costs up exponentially as well. On top of all these factors, costs associated with longer boats usually increase on a per foot basis by a factor of three. Lastly, this summer I'll be working on a project in my role as Three Rivers Waterkeeper with the nonprofit large-scale river cleanup organization, Living Lands and Waters, to remove cars from the bottom of the river in the Pittsburgh Pool. We'll have divers, police, and Living Lands and Waters experienced operators using a long reach excavator on a barge pushed by their towboat. We'll lift cars onto the barge and have local police verify VIN information on the cars, and they will be sent to the scrapyard. Simple as that. I'd also like to remove boats as well, but I'm concerned that it won't be possible unless we are enabled with some good solutions to deal with potential ownership issues. And then I'll talk about possible solutions now. As I've described, and as I'm sure others will or could testify, this is a very complicated issue. Lastly, based on my experience, I'd like to offer these thoughts and suggestions to further spark conversations by this committee, the Pennsylvania Fish and Boat Commission, public and private partners, and the boating community. In the short term, I'd like to consider creating a local pilot program in Pittsburgh to dispose of ADVs, which could also help with a study of aspects of the work required and test the feasibility for ideas. This is most cost-effective and easier in the Pittsburgh region due to the interested local groups who partner with, and many of the well-known ADVs, well-equipped salvors, and the ease of working in main stem rivers as opposed to shallow rivers or small lakes where infrastructure is limited and less use causes issues to occur more infrequently. And of course, the oceans or harbors and Great Lakes depths and adverse conditions would make the salvage work very difficult. I'd like to look for guaranteed payment to handle legal liability issues for salvors. This could set precedent and realistic expectations for a larger program to eventually design and implement. Search for incentive and solutions to help owners deal responsibly with boats at end of life, carrots before sticks. Study disposal costs and techniques. Continue the work of assessing best practices and applicability in other states. Further clarification of laws. Specifically, there seems to be an issue around boats tied to land. Are they considered on the waters of the Commonwealth or the navigable waters of the United States? This is something that we've heard complicates enforcement of laws around our point of Pittsburgh, as well as when these floods happen and boats land on shore, are they a boat that is then ADV stuck on land and then the landowner's problem? We also should have studies to find possibilities of real penalties for abandoning and dumping boats and opportunities to recoup costs for salvage and disposal. Develop an educational program for the public and marina owners about the cost of disposal and techniques. Investigate insurance laws as possible tool. And in the long term, I'd like to suggest reviewing existing laws, amend or create new laws with additional teeth, continue and promote a larger education and outreach campaign, create a permanent program and fund to deal with abandoned boats funded from boat registration, like in Florida, and also from fines as well as recouping salvage costs from responsible parties. And again, support for salvage businesses to guarantee their payment and clearly and simply handle legal liability issues for salvors. Chairs Kulik and Maloney, this concludes my statement on the behalf of Pittsburgh Safe Boating Council, and we thank you for putting a spotlight on this issue and holding this hearing today, and I appreciate the opportunity to testify, and we'd be glad to answer any questions you may have. Thank you.
Thank you so much. And I would like to let you know that we have several representatives from across the state who are online, members of the committee. We have, along with Chair Maloney, we have Representative McNeil, Representative Banta, Representative Haddock, Representative Mursky, and with us today, of course, we have Representative Steele, and we are now joined by Representative Kincaid, who has come to join our committee on this issue. I appreciate everyone being here. And we will continue now with Richard Lynn of Pittsburgh River Rescue. Oh, okay. Then, okay, now then we'll move on to our next speaker. And that would be, is it Alana Keating, who is here from Boat USA Foundation? Oh, she is online. Okay. Good morning.
Good morning. Yes, this is Alana Keating. I'm the Director of Outreach with Boat US Foundation, here representing Boat US and Boat US Foundation. And I want to thank the committee and the other presenters for having us here today to talk about the issue of ADVs. On behalf of the over 750,000 members of Boat US, the Boat Owners Association of the United States, including over 16,000 in Pennsylvania, we appreciate the opportunity to offer our comments on the issues surrounding abandoned and derelict vessels. Our members enjoy many different recreational boating activities on all types of water around the country while using a wide range of boats and types. The committee should also note that Boat US Foundation for Boating Safety and Clean Water, the nonprofit arm of Boat US, is the leader in safe and clean boating education and outreach. The Boat US Foundation reaches more than a million boaters each year with messaging to help promote behavior change in the boating community. For more than a decade, we have been working on the issues of abandoned and derelict vessels, or ADVs, in partnership with NOAA and the boating community. The foundation was recently awarded a $10 million grant from NOAA to address the removal and prevention of ADVs on a national level in partnership with organizations across the country. Boat US Foundation has worked with many states in creating and improving their programs around ADVs, including participating in Virginia's Abandoned and Derelict Vessel Working Group that has been working to address the issues around ADVs in the state and establish a state program. In general, ADVs are any vessel that pose a threat to the environment. They can range from small sailboats to large commercial trawlers and barges. But like a lot of things, there's no one definition of what makes something an ADV. In many cases, the vessel owners are either unidentifiable, cannot be reached, or unable to address the issue. While ADVs have a different official definition in different localities, they all have some common attributes and impacts. ADVs pose hazards to navigation, safety, and the environment, and are a serious problem across the country. The impacts from ADVs are wide-ranging. They can easily pose navigation hazards for boaters and cause environmental concerns around spillage of oil and fuel, chemicals, and other hazardous materials. These hazards can end up in sensitive habitats and impact seafloor or aquatic vegetation. There are multiple reasons boats become abandoned or derelict. It could be a disposal challenge, an aging or deceased owner, boats being used as a housing solution, or wrecked due to hurricanes and other storms. Whether it's a lack of affordable housing in an affluent area or affordable options for disposal, ADVs can accumulate to the detriment of the overall environment. A lack of options and additional resources for removal and education of those options and resources will cause ADVs. Regardless of the reasons, ADVs are a challenging issue that require collaboration across local, state, and federal agencies, as well as the boating communities themselves. Like many issues, the challenges around ADVs can be vast and nuanced. Boat US Foundation believes that many of these challenges fall within broad categories, such as laws and policies, funding, removal and disposal, and prevention and outreach. Each of these need to be addressed in partnership with stakeholders to tackle the wider problem of ADVs effectively and efficiently. There are many barriers to effective management and prevention of ADVs. In many jurisdictions, the laws and policies around identifying and addressing ADVs can be unclear, piecemeal, challenging to navigate, and burdensome to those who are trying to remove ADVs. Dedicated, sustainable funding is needed to address historical ADVs and work towards preventing their reoccurrence. Accurate and timely identification and removal of ADVs is crucial because the costs and challenges around removal increase the longer the vessel sits. Additionally, disposal of aging boats is costly, and there are no widespread sustainable disposal solutions. This results in not only ADVs, but increased financial burden. Boat US fully supports Pennsylvania working with a variety of stakeholders across the Commonwealth and local communities to develop strategies and solutions to address the issues of ADVs. We look forward to working with them on how best to address this complex and challenging problem. In closing, recreational boaters and anglers have an abiding interest in the protection of our waterways, as do other recreational users of public lands. We are on the water, in the water, and eat fish from the water and wish to see these special places protected. We also need to be able to reach these locations in many different ways. Providing appropriate access is crucial to the long-term political and financial support for national parks and public lands. We appreciate the opportunity to bring the voice of voters before this committee, and we are available to answer any questions that the committee may have.
Thank you. Do we have anyone from River Rescue? Okay. Can I put any of you on the spot today? Okay, great. If you want to come up and introduce yourself to everyone.
Just push the button here?
Yeah.
Oh, it's on. Okay.
It's on.
Yeah.
So,
I'm sorry, guys.
Go ahead. No, go ahead.
I'm Officer David Blayhut with the Pittsburgh Bureau of Police. I've been a police officer for, in June, will be 31 years. I've been on Pittsburgh River Rescue for 19 of those years.
Okay. And just with yesterday, with everything happening, were there any issues with abandoned boats yesterday that had to be dealt with?
Yes. Last night, around 4 o'clock in the morning, we got a call for a capsized boat. We've been getting a lot of those over the past couple of days, and we had to go down and actually investigate that boat. The danger with that is we have to check these boats out, and that means there's a possibility of actually having to put divers in the water. With this increased flow, though, we generally try not to do that because of the danger, but there is a possibility that our divers could be seriously injured or killed trying to check an abandoned boat, and we had one last night.
In this weather, where the rivers are very swift right now, is it a bigger danger now having these boats that we just saw, one floating, and are they a danger to the barges, to other boaters, et cetera?
Absolutely. With the increased flow, we're getting a lot more debris, obviously, coming down the river, and a lot of those are boats. The one that we just seen actually drift past was, I believe, the one that was stuck by the Gateway Clipper, where they would actually have to pull in. So that would have had to have been removed. But obviously, that's you know, going down the river now. But with all the debris coming down, yeah, it definitely is a danger to the boats that are actually on the water now that they could be struck.
Is there anything you want to add to the conversation today?
Yes. I know on the law enforcement side, our hands are kind of tied because there's only so much, you know, we can do with these boats. I actually made a form letter myself through just our unit, and when I run the registration, I actually send the mail out. I mean, we actually have, I mean, that's kind of off point, but we have like a kitty where I can get, you know, postage, and I send it out ourselves just to try to get some sort of, people coming and contacting us. The big issue, I think, would be the enforcement side, what we can and can't do, and also I think on our side, too, would be the storage and a location where we could put these boats. But other than that, I mean, we'd be ready to do what we have to do to get these off the water.
Thank you so much for letting me put you in the hot seat today.
No problem. Thank you.
I appreciate it.
Thank you.
I'm going to now, Representative Maloney, if you can get on with us, I'm going to give you a chance first to ask any questions or make any comments.
Yeah, thank you very much. I can assume you can hear me?
Yes, we can.
Okay. So a lot of things come front and center to me with probably some of the things that representatives have dealt with to some degree across the state. And I'm just going to run down a few things. And I know there was a lot of discussion and testimony on the challenges. And I think most of us would have understood that, or at least it was good to hear to what extent there's possibly no answers to. But a couple of things I wanted to go over with respect to how we as representatives deal with somebody who may have a boat or trailer. So I have dealt with several of these, even with personal friends who, let me run down this, divorce, estates, purchasing a piece of property with a trailer or a vessel on it, and very difficult to identify a VIN number, a title of any kind. And so those challenges exist for us as to how we help somebody to even prove ownership. And I think for the most part, as long as we can go back in time enough, then we get into a problem where we can't identify somebody. I didn't know if there was ever anything that was suggested or put in place that, look, I heard for years and years that Philadelphia had all these abandoned vehicles on their streets, and at some point in time, somebody started to vacuum them up. And literally I use that word on purpose. But at some point in time, there is a private property issue. And one of the things that I speak to that for the reason of is, if you are a property owner, to some of the folks who testified today, have they run into a problem where somebody says, look, I don't know who owns this vessel, whether this is municipal property or personal property, state or federal property. If there is a vessel sitting on your property, do we take a legal action to just remove it? And if we do that, do they go to a scrapyard, a designated area? I believe it was Boat USA testified to a $10 million amount of money that was released for that type of challenge. So I guess what I'm getting at is, I know there's been some suggestions, but what would be a purposeful outcome to this hearing where we would say, you know what, I think that wasn't discussed. I think we didn't know that that was a hiccup, and this is how we would do it, just like we would do a car that's left on the street, or somebody has a right to clean up their property and it has been left there. Because I know a personal friend of mine was given a boat and a trailer by somebody who said, no, I never had a title to that. So we were able to backtrack and get that, but you have to get verification from the last owner as to, okay, this is what we did, and you can move on. But what are the chances of when these vessels are on private property or even municipal property, where we should be able to, I say should, be able to take action? Does anybody have any like real suggestions as to cleaning them up?
Okay, Executive Director, would you like to, I know we've had these conversations with you.
Happy to come up, and also happy for any of my colleagues from the Fish and Boat Commission or Boat USA, anybody else to join me for this. I think part of the goal of today was to put the issue out there, so thanks for doing that. Thanks to Evan for laying out a number. I mean, whether it's funding, whether it's regulations, whether it's legislation, whether it's chain of title issues, whether it's storage, what you do with them afterwards, some sort of pot of money to deal with this. I think the idea of a pilot here in Allegheny County would make a ton of sense. But the goal today was to get this on the table, and I do think we need to sort form a work group around this, that we've sort of informally done it. But now's the time to really, you know, put our money where our mouth is. So I can tell you that I'll work with our staff, I'll work with our partners. We don't need legislation or a resolution to form the work group. That's just something that we can do. And I think we would love to have members of the legislature, if there are members of this committee that would like to join, if there are staffers, if there's members that have these issues in your district, you know, become a part of that work group with us. We'll give ourselves a deadline to come up with solutions. And if there are elements that need legislation, we'll share that with you. I know that you've expressed an interest in introducing legislation. I think the goal of today, though, was getting everything on the table. We've done that. We'd be happy to now take the lead in putting that all in the mix, seeing what we can do as an agency, what you guys need to do as the legislature, what we could maybe be looking to the federal government on, what we can be looking to our local government partners to help with. But I'd say, you know, Chairman Maloney, it's time to get to work, right? I mean, we put it out there. Thank you guys for raising this. We had the good fortune, or maybe bad fortune if you're downstream, of having that boat float by to put sort of an exclamation point on this. But Dave or Chairman Maloney, it's time for us to get to work. We'll come with recommendations to you and the legislature for things you could do, and identify what we could do on our own and maybe with our federal partners.
Chair, you still have the floor.
Yeah, okay, thank you so much. Tim, I appreciate that. That makes a lot of sense. Even with the think tank put together, if you will, I wonder if, and maybe you guys know this answer, and it doesn't have to be today, but what do we do with maybe surrounding states that may have had this issue or are trying to address it? I know that we have boats that make it onto Pennsylvania property that came from out of state. Yeah. And that might be another challenge too, right? Yeah,
for sure. And, you know, Virginia was mentioned, and I'm going to be with my counterpart from Virginia, Ryan Brown, in 2 weeks. The Northeast Association of Fish and Wildlife Agencies directors get together twice a year, so I will certainly consult with him. But, yeah, I think we need to learn from them. I think we also, you know, we sort of joked about the river floating by, but now that's somebody else's problem, right? And it's going to be West Virginia's problem if it makes it there. So not something we can just shrug off and say, well, it's not our problem anymore. It's still somebody's problem. So, yeah, the interstate aspect of that, and I think the interstate aspect of it would also suggest, you know, some, you know, federal action at that point once you've got these issues that are crossing state lines. And I'll say this sincerely. This wasn't, you know, scripted for me to come up here, but, if anybody of our partners would like to take a stab at this, what we do next, I'm happy to share the floor here. But we'll be happy to take the lead.
Thank you, Chairwoman. I just wanted to put that out there in the light of it was great conversation, and it is very helpful putting those things together that we would be able to identify, and maybe there's not a whole lot the legislature can do, but once the awareness has come front and center, then we know maybe how or who we can look to helping us with that. So thanks so very much. I appreciate that, Tim.
Yeah, and thank you. I mean, right there, Chairman Maloney just nailed it, right? It's now on the table. We'd been discussing this. We'd had these conversations in this room, but now it's out there. And I hope the media pays attention to this. I hope other legislators pay attention to this and just know that we're going to take it seriously, and we'll take the lead on coming up with recommendations for you and your colleagues.
Anything else, Chair?
No, I think that's it. Thank you so much. And really, thanks everybody for participating in this. And I just really wonder who got paid to float that boat down there.
It was not a setup. It was just like, look between Representative Steele and Senator Williams, and there it was.
You know, Chair, things happen in Pittsburgh like this. We're just really good in Western PA with putting on a show for everyone.
Evidently. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Sure. Yep. And again, I mean it, guys. If anybody's got something else to offer up, feel free to join me.
Senator, would you like to make any comments or ask questions?
I do have a question or two. And, Tim, I'm glad you're still sitting there.
Yeah.
So two of the other testifiers, and you also talked about a fund to deal with the ADVs. Mm. I know Mr. McArdle mentioned using diversion of funds from the vehicle recreational vehicle registration fees. How would that work on the finances of the commission? Because I know you have like uses for those fees already. Would it have to be a separate fee? Have you thought about that?
Yeah, it would need to be some sort of additional source of revenue, whether it's, you know, I'd be reluctant to tack something on to the cost of a boat registration, but if there could be some sort of, you know, fund that we could work with the General Assembly to identify that gets allocated that we could help to administer, but it would be tough to divert resources although I will say, though, could our partner at Boat USA talk more about that federal grant?
Oh, yeah, can we get a piece of that?
Yeah, could we talk about that if that person's still online?
I am still online. Right. I can talk in some generalities. We are aiming for, we did receive this grant. It will be a sub-award competition. So we will be providing grants out to other organizations. It is open to state, local, for-profit, nonprofit organizations all to apply for the funding for removal and prevention of ADVs. Our first letter of intent and round of funding is anticipated to be available in spring of this year. And we hope to have more than one round of funding. We are continuing to work with NOAA on several different parts of this. And I would completely support Fish and Boats Commission's suggestion of a work group. We've provided some information on what Virginia has done, and they have done a lot of the legwork for a lot of other states on reviewing policy, looking at funding sources. There is an extensive information in their reporting that can help any state start from an even better place on what would work best for the state. But there's many different ways to look into funding opportunities and options to fund a state program.
Great. And I did ask Laurel Anders, who is our deputy executive director, to join me and had most recently been our director of our Bureau of Boating. And I was pretty sure we were applying for that. So I sort of whispered to her, I said, are we doing that? So Laurel, if you could talk about our intentions with that, please.
Yes. And first, I wanted to just thank Alana Keating for being part of the hearing this morning. They are extremely short-staffed at Boat U.S. Foundation. And the person that I had previously worked with at Boat U.S. Foundation, who's now gone, but he and I had been coordinating closely on preparing for a grant application to try to leverage some of that $10 million that came through. So that's part of our motivation to really call partners together and develop an internal work group and a staff research effort to try to find out what other states are doing so we could be really well prepared and poised to apply for this funding. And then inviting, Alana to be here today has also helped us understand what their priorities are for the program and the funding. So as soon as that is announced, we will be one of the first applicants we anticipate.
And so we'll definitely do that. But I think whoever made the point, the term sustainable and dedicated funding for this, we can apply for that grant and we will, and optimistic that we could be successful. But then what comes next? And, the next boat that floats down the river. So certainly avail ourselves of that, but also look for ways to make it more sustainable and permanent.
And my second question, and Mr. Clark talked about this, and Mr. Clark, Captain Clark, if you want to answer, or maybe Tim too, the idea of searching for incentives to help owners deal with responsibly at the end of their life. What are some ideas? Are there other states that do the incentive and the carrot before the stick? Because if we're talking about owners who may have taken on, too much, bit off more than they could chew, and now they don't have the funds to properly get rid of the boat, putting fines and fees and things on doesn't actually help them get rid of the boat. So are there ideas in that space before they get into the water?
Yeah, I can't speak that to that yet, Evan.
I don't know
Paul,
if somebody has...
Looks like you got two new guys.
All right.
I mean, feel free, both of you, to step up if you can add to the conversation.
Back in the hot seat here. I actually don't have any initial thoughts on that. I'm very excited about a working group to look into that, because obviously carrots before sticks is the best way to deal with these things if at the education component before that were to fail.
I think there are two things. One is that when you have a vessel that's out there that needs to be removed, very often the owner either is hard to identify, or what happens quite frequently is that when the boat gets, and I'm being a little loose, but when the boat gets 60% shot, it gets sold to another person. When it gets 80% shot, it gets sold to another person. So by the time that boat is floating in the river, the person who owns it doesn't have very deep pockets. And that happens frequently. So one method to address this is what the state of Florida did, is they set aside funding to remove a boat if the owner essentially turns the boat over to the government agency, and they will then turn it over, and then the state picks up the cost of that disposal. So that's one way that other states have addressed it.
Thank you, Chairwoman. I appreciate allowing me to participate in this today.
Well, you are most welcome to be here. All right, we're going to hit a couple of our reps online. Is Representative Banta available.
Hello, can you hear me now?
Yes, we can. Go ahead.
Okay, good to be here. Thank you, Chairwoman. Thank you, Chairman, for being online there. And thank you guys, everybody in the room, for showing up. We're kind of wet and cold up here, so I hope everybody's fine down there and safe. That said, my questions are for anybody that's very knowledgeable and what actually, what happens with the, what are these boats distributing in the water? Obviously, oil or gas is not good, but can somebody give me the ecological, trauma or the, not trauma, but the, what it does to the water, what it does for these boats is sit in that water in that oil, anything, basically anything that's in the water has the, you know, the risk of leaking. And so what does that do to our water table? What does that do to our water? If anybody could fill me in on that and give me some knowledge on that. Thank you.
So there's several different types of contaminants that can come from a boat. And I think that what we see and what we're all intimately familiar with are the oil, gas, and those types of petroleum products, which are known to be hazards to wildlife and the environment in general. Those, one of the reasons why you want to address the boat early on is that those fluids leak out quickly. And so the boat gets bumped around, the lower unit breaks off, or a hull gets perforated in one way or another, and those things leak out pretty quickly. So one of the whole purposes of separating between an at-risk vessel and a derelict vessel is to be able to get at the vessel to get those contaminates off the vessel before it becomes derelict and then spills in. So the first thing we'll talk about is the fuels. The second thing are all of the plastics that are in a boat that break up and enter the waterway. They may be less visible, but they still have the same contaminating factors. And thirdly is fiberglass, which also is a contaminant that accumulates. And so the boats, when they get in the water and they start bouncing around, these little pieces break off. And think of it with the idea of microplastics, that they just get into the system and they're impossible to remove. So that's one of the motivations to try to address it. And we had talked about earlier, somebody mentioned the two different phases. One is addressing the boats that are already there, and the second is a program to keep boats from coming there in the future.
Any other? We can't hear you, Representative.
I'm sorry.
Now
thank
we
you.
Can. You're good now.
Yes, I'm sorry. Yeah, I shut it off. So it is. Thank you very much, sir. It is safe to say that anything that is put in the water with fluids that can be toxic is something that needs monitored and looked at, and we need to consider that anytime anything is put in the water. Yes.
Yeah, that's agreed.
Agreed. Yes, absolutely.
Yeah, I guess what I'm getting at is when we talk about our waterways, we need to take in consideration anything that we're putting in the water. So thanks for your time. I appreciate your testimony, everybody. Thank you.
Thank you, Representative Haddock.
Good morning. Somebody talked about it earlier. Education is certainly paramount in this issue. As an average boatsman and fisherman, no matter where you travel, you see these ADVs. And I always wondered why somebody would take a recreational vehicle that came from originally expendable income and an asset and let them just deteriorate. It's mind-boggling to me that it can go downhill that fast and then become an eyesore and an environmental and a safety hazard all in one. But you know, the owner, when we come up with this plan, I really think owners have to be held responsible. And that's issue number one, especially when we can find the owner. And there are ways to take judgments in the court system against owners that cost governments money. So I would hope that when we start formulating this, we look at that avenue and holding the actual owner responsible. Because again, if a boat has some value, or if a trailer, to Rep. Maloney's comment, if it's in a yard, you know, you can go into, you know, if it's on private property, you can go to court and you can get a court order for the title for the boat and or the trailer and take it over. The problem is if it doesn't have the value, it's not worth the expense and time to go into the court system. So this is a complex issue all the way around, but I think, you know, when we're formulating the plan, I would like to strongly suggest we hold the owners accountable as part of this plan. And then where the money comes from, I didn't know. I know somebody mentioned this, last speaker mentioned, I didn't catch the name, you know, Florida. And of course, Virginia has a plan already. Where did they actually come up with the funding avenues for their plan that are already in place? Does anybody know, or can we elaborate on that quickly?
It's a legislature allocation.
Yeah, Elena here from Boat US. Virginia has been allocated money through the state, a state program. They have also received a NOAA grant separate from the funding that Boat US Foundation has received for removal. NOAA does provide funding for large-scale marine debris removal, usually every 2 years. They do not have a full state program yet. They are still working through a plan to develop it. And then Florida has received state funding, and they do have a robust plan that includes building in funding solutions with some of the removal efforts and holding owners accountable, or solutions like that.
Okay, thank you.
I'm not sure if it's a thing as well that Florida has some money that's tacked on to annual registration fees for boat owners as well, that helps them deal with their abandoned derelict vessels and their fund.
I do want to point out the Coast Guard has told all states that they cannot have tack on fees for registrations. So that's a route that we can't implement.
Okay, thank you, Rep. Haddock. Is one of the problems, so while we're talking about this, is one of the problems that there is no inherent value to these boats? They're not, a vehicle has scrap metal. We can always do something with a car. But fiberglass is not something we can recycle or use again. Is that one of the problems that we're facing?
Very much so. One of the things that you would think, right, is that if the boat had a salvage value that was enough to make it worth it, there's a very robust set of laws about salvage. And, you know, people be coming in to remove these boats if they could make some money off of that, but it doesn't work that way, in the sense that most times these boats have very little, if any, value.
There has been some work that's been done to reuse ground up fiberglass from fiberglass boats, but so far, at least to my knowledge, none of that has practical or value-added applications with those ground-up fiberglass being used in concrete admixtures or anything like that.
Alana here with Boat US Foundation again. Absolutely, there a lot of these boats do not have a value. They are also not able to dispose of them affordably before or after they become abandoned or derelict, before they enter the waterway or float away. The disposal options for fiberglass are very limited across the country and vary from locality to locality. Some landfills will take them, some will not. And usually you need to pay somebody to break it up to take it to a landfill. We have worked with Rhode Island Marine Trade Association on a pilot for fiberglass recycling. Washington State Sea Grant is also working on a pilot for fiberglass recycling. And we continue to work with various states and partners across the country looking at some sustainable solutions for addressing fiberglass.
Okay. Rep. Steele.
Thank you, Chair Kulik. This was very informative, so thank you so much to all the testifiers that are here today. Three things that stood out to me are that boats floating by our hearings are going to start to happen more and more now that we're seeing the climate change driven in the more frequent high volume rain events. So this is going to be a problem that's going to get worse as we move forward. The point about fuels and other hazardous materials leaking into our rivers, which is our water that we drink, and the danger to the officers that have to go into these boats and sometimes go into the water to deal with these hazards, that's alarming. My question, Chair Kulik just addressed, was is there some kind of model pertaining to land vehicles that we could replicate here? But I understand that because there's not value in the materials that can be salvaged there really is probably not a comparable model. So given all of that, it seems to me that identifying the at-risk vehicles is the would be the most efficient path. And how would that happen? How would you propose that we identify which vehicles are at risk of becoming abandoned?
It's a little bit complicated in the sense that where does the report come from? So it's a vessel shows up, somebody calls it in. As I kind of laid out, that an officer would need to go and investigate whether it's a problem, whether there's at risk, and then whether there's an at-risk problem, and then what needs to be done. And I also want to point out as a layer in this that not only do I very much appreciate your comment on the safety, but also that there's a shortage of officers, and so you need to be judicious in what you're sending them out to do. And so I think part of this is the process of identifying whether it's a risk and then coming up with an action plan of whether you're going to intervene in some way or another. Again, even if you have an at-risk vessel, there's going to be limitations as to what you're going to send an officer out for if the water is high and dangerous, and in other ways. You would need to have somebody who's really a professional at that instead of just sending an officer out to actually do the mitigation.
That's true.
Depends on the circumstance.
And if we have success drawing down some of that federal funding, really we could potentially have officers going out to these vehicles that we have identified as at risk and just giving them a letter that says, hey, there's this program where you can get rid of this boat for free.
Right, and at least they can do the assessment portion without burdening them with something that they would need training and manpower to do.
Thank you.
Yep.
Thank you. Representative Kincaid.
Thank you. Thank you, Chairwoman, for allowing me to be an honorary member of the committee today. I think this is a really important issue, and you know, I appreciate our Fish and Boat Commission folks who actually educated me about this to begin with, other than just seeing the random boats that were in the water and going, why is this here? Why has it been here for years? I don't understand. So you brought up an interesting point that I think, you know, is something that we need to be considering also, is that there are owners who sort of recognize that their boats are coming to the end of their useful life, and that in certain ways they're selling them kind of in an exploitative way, and putting that burden on somebody who, you know, wants to have a boat but can't necessarily afford to buy a new boat. And I wonder if there's something that we could do in that space as well, about, you know, I mean, when people buy homes, they are encouraged to get inspections. And I don't know if there's something that exists in that space to help boat purchasers to be able to understand sort of where in the lifespan of the boat it is, so that they're able to purchase with full knowledge and not necessarily be sort of exploited with a boat that they can't then dispose of because they don't have the funds to be able to do it.
It's really a great question. And I think that people, you know, to directly answer your question, there are things, there are marine surveyors who can go and assess a vessel and let you know its condition, just like a home inspector. Whether or not that is practical on a small 23-foot thing is debatable. They may or may not be able to give you much information, and they may cost more than, you know, reasonably the boat would cost. So there are some limits there. I think part of it, and it's a little philosophical, is that people buy these boats partially on a dream, right? They want this experience to be out on a boat, and they see something and they say, I can fix that. And then they get it and they find out, gee, I can't. And then they're stuck with the boat. And so I think that's part of how it gets there, is that people buy boats thinking they can fix them up, and then it's either too much time or too much money, and then they're looking for an exit strategy, and they either dump them or sell it to the next guy.
And I think with those boats, or with the homes that you talked about, there's you know, banks that limit giving loans to certain homes, and insurers as well. And when we start to get into the lower end of value in boats, and neither of those at the moment have any relevance to that situation. So it's pretty tricky to regulate or help or monitor.
Mr. McCardle, would you like to weigh in? We need you at a mic, though.
There we go. Just kind of building off of that point, just wanted to mention that NMMA, we actually do a boat certification program. We work very closely with Coast Guard, state agencies, etc. So all the newer boats coming off of our members' lines are certified as being safe and, you know, not posing threats to the immediate environment. And just something to know about that is that certification program really started around the early 2000s. And when you look at watercraft, the life cycle use of a watercraft over a 12-month span is usually somewhere between 60 to 72 hours on the water. So it's very, you know, less. They usually have a lot longer life cycle. But I think really the challenge is coming in when we're looking at some of these boats that still might be out there from the 70s, 80s, 90s even, that pre-exist some of those certifications. So just to add kind of that extra layer of context.
Thank you.
Anyone in the audience, if you would like to ask a question now, we do have a mic up here. You need to hit the button so it goes green. But if anybody has a question or a comment. Yeah. Oh, thank you, Rep.
Thank you. Thank you for everybody in the committee for hearing this issue. It's important. I just want to add one thing, and that is, you know, I've been a veteran boater in Pittsburgh for a little over 30 years. I own the Freedom Boat Club franchise here. I'm also the vice president of the Pittsburgh Safe Boating Council. And the thing that I want to mention is that this issue is accelerating. When I started boating in Pittsburgh 30 years ago, the idea of an abandoned boat left at downtown really didn't exist. And the reason this issue is more important to me, it's a personal issue close to my heart, is that I think among the boating community, there's two views of it. There is those of us who find that horrifying, that anybody would ever do that. And there are those who bought boats that they probably can't afford, that see it as just an easy way to get rid of the problem. The issue to me is that socially, I guess the way of saying it, in the boating community, there is a group of people who now realize that the easiest way to get rid of a boat is to tie it to the North Shore wall. I just wanted to say that just for the sake of making sure that the importance of this issue is maybe more so now than it ever has been before, and it seems to be accelerating.
Thanks. Anyone else? You want to grab that mic down there?
Hello, my name is Teresa King. I'm from the Sport and Exhibition Authority. I'm the program specialist. And so we own and operate the North Shore Riverfront Park. So that's from the Science Center to PNC Park. And so first I want to thank everyone. Evan did a great job of really stating the concerns that we're facing today with the environmental and even the public safety concerns, because we also manage the property in front of the Convention Center. And as was just noted, we're seeing a very increased number of boats that have been left on our property, and it is very hard to manage. So we're really looking forward to the new ordinance and a streamlined process of being able to have this issue resolved. Thank you.
Thank you. Would you like to?
I don't know if this would be feasible or not, but I just discussed with Officer Mike Johnson, you know, when you sign for your registration, you give an applied consent on the littering laws. Is there any way when you sign for your boat registration that's tacked on to that, like an applied consent, like for DUI, for, you know, blood draws, or, like I said, when you sign for your registration, you sign for the littering laws. I don't know if that could be enacted, that when you sign for your registration, your boater registration, there's an applied consent that this could possibly happen and your boat could possibly be removed in the future. I don't know if that could occur.
Well, thank you. Actually, in the House, we do have a work in progress right now on this matter. And you know, the issues we talked about today, anything new that we have not addressed, we will be looking at from the House committee.
Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else? And, you know, we have several. Come on up.
Is there any way to inspect these vessels before they even go into the water themselves, like similar to what we do on the roads for cars, to make sure they're safe to be on the roads? Why can't we make it mandatory to have these boats inspected, similar to cars, have a mechanic look it over and see what the hazard the boat may present to be put on the water? Like if this vessel isn't capable of being floating on the water, it's leaking oils and everything else, let's get it now before it even attempts to enter the water. So that's one question I wanted to bring in. The other is, from the insurance perspective of things, is why is it not mandatory to have insurance on the boats where, you know, if anything was to happen, in a sense, your insurance will cover for somebody to come get this boat. As far as my insurance, I had an issue. I, you know, ran into a structure right on Davis Island down near Neville Island and such. And, you know, one of the organizations basically had told me to just leave the boat. Just leave it there and the insurance will deal. Just get off the boat and just leave the boat. And that was essentially it. And obviously I wasn't just going to leave my vessel there with 800 gallons of diesel on it and hope for the best. So some of these points that I wanted to bring up is, before these vessels get in the water, let's stop that. Not knocking the marinas and such, but hold them accountable as far as what vessels they have sitting in their parking lots that nobody's touching, whatever else that seem to end up in the river miraculously. How do we ultimately stop that? There's volunteers out there also that'll help the state organizations, whatever else, that'll put an end to this ourselves. I mean, the volunteers that'll, you know, tow these boats, crush them up, do whatever you have to do. I mean, you could tap that resource as the groups that are in Pittsburgh that'll help with that. So if there's a funding issue, there's people to volunteer to get rid of those. Fiberglass is an issue. They run into the same issue with the fiberglass blades on windmills. What do you do with this? Do you take these vessels? You can't make them a natural reef. I mean, that's another issue. Could you make them into a park? Can you put them into concrete, into asphalts? I mean, there's got to be some issues there. I mean, I'm definitely keep us in a loop as far as what needs to be done. We're with Pittsburgh Boat Life. We have 6,300 members. I mean, we definitely would like to be a part of any of these decisions and input that we could put in and help out on.
Well, I appreciate you speaking. Thank you.
Sorry, I rambled on. It was a rebel.
No, not at all. Thank you. Any comments on?
Insurance, of course, is governed at the state level, and most states do not require insurance. There are a handful of states that do require boaters to have insurance, but most do not, and that's something that is a decision at the legislative level as to whether that would be appropriate. I think as far as inspections, I think I have two kind of points on that. One is, you know, marinas and Coast Guard Auxiliary do inspections that can help identify some of these problems. But I think deeper than that is inspections require really a regimen. What is inspected, how is inspected, and so on. And it's not really simple to just say boats need to be inspected. You really need to have a regimen of what you're inspecting, how it's done, a system, a program, etc. So I think it's a very reasonable, I appreciate the thought, but I think there are some challenges to implementing a statewide inspection regimen.
Just building off that real quickly, I just want to say, as far as the inspection process goes, I think what we've seen within the industry is that for a lot of the newer vessels that, you know, are in existence right now, 2005, 2010 to present, let's say, it's much easier to track those inspections and to make sure that they were done, in a very, judicious manner, and to kind of continue following that life cycle. I think where it gets really difficult is when you see the used boat market. Oftentimes, it's kind of like the used car market in plenty of instances where it's, person-to-person sale, and it's not fully tracked. So, I definitely agree with the comments that Paul made. I think it is tough, it gets difficult. But in the same token, I know that the state of both Florida and Washington are currently looking at including in their ADV programs some provisions for like continual life cycle inspection. But there is, I know, a significant cost potentially to the state at play there.
And they've been doing a little triage on that as well as including larger boats, commercial boats, fishing boats, and so on in that, as opposed to the smaller recreational vessel.
Okay, any other comments? Chair Maloney, any closing remarks?
I appreciate it. It's interesting always for me to hear some of the other challenges that we may not know or maybe we take for granted. I'm just going to circle back to a couple of things that I think I heard, and I appreciate what Executive Director Tim Schaefer said when he would caution anybody putting an extra fee on boat registration. And I wholeheartedly agree with that. I would be cautious to the fees and the user negative, if you will, with the things that we got to remember. Today we're talking about mostly abandoned. And I think that's what we have to focus on, the fact that what happens once this does take place. And so I'd never want to give any legislative gift to the insurance agent anymore, but sorry for any brokers that may be listening, but that's personally my feeling. And another thing is that, we got to go back to the fact that we have a struggle with the unexpected. And to me, that's more about where we're at and trying to stay focused on that. So, just remember, folks, there's a great joke out there. Best 2 days of your life was the day you bought a boat, and the second was the day you sold it. So there's a reason that takes place. And we want to be as nice to the boating industry as we can for the recreational of it, but we obviously should understand there's a responsibility that comes with everything. So thanks for everybody. I really appreciate the discussion, and thank you, Chairwoman, and I'll row my boat out.
Thank you, Chairman. In closing, I just want to thank everyone for coming. This was a wonderful, wonderful turnout for this. So everyone knows, we have already had extensive discussions on this topic with the Fish and Boat Commission. And as I said, there is a work in progress in the House right now that we will be tweaking and going through, and to make sure whatever we can come up with addresses the issue properly. As we just saw with a boat floating right by, it is an issue. We all have it. I'm sure my colleagues sitting here with me today and my colleagues who are online have this problem, because so many of us sit on the water. I have the Ohio River. I've got lovely Neville Township on Neville Island, and McKees Rocks and Stowe Township and Coriopolis Borough that, you know, sit on the Ohio River and have to deal with these issues. And I know my colleagues have the same issues in their municipalities. So we want to address this. We're taking it very seriously. I am thrilled that you all came today. And I really especially want to thank all our officers who are here today. They are always there. Director, they're always there when I need something. And I know they're always there when my colleagues need their help with any issues. And I want y'all to stay safe, because I know your job is every bit as dangerous as any police officer on land. I know you have to deal with a lot, and we, especially with this weather, and if you are out on the waters, we want you to be safe. So thank you, officers, for coming out here today. With that, I will adjourn this meeting. You're all welcome to stay and chat with each other if you need to. I know that the folks who testified today would be more than willing to talk with all of you who came. And again, we're going to be working on this issue, so thank you.